thank you for showing up. It's quite overwhelming with so many people. Basically, we are all dependent on our senses. So our ability to see, listen, smell, taste, and feel our surroundings are essential for us to act. So if we just want to do a simple task or more advanced task, well, we need our senses to sense the environment in order to us to act appropriately. And similar, if you have intelligent machines, advanced robotic systems, you need to have some kind of sensors to sense the environment so these systems can act accordingly. And one particular interesting sense in this context is the ability to see. So that's just a picture of a cat. And I want to differentiate between we use our eyes to capture visual information. However, it's the brain that actually do the process, the interpretation of the information, and eventually translates into a cat. So humans are incredible at doing this, and within a blink of a second, you can spot individual objects in the room, and you can recognize your mom or dad or whatever, and see if they're happy or sad or threatening or stuff like this. So, but this is also very interesting for robots. So researchers have tried to make the same pipeline. So in this sense, you might have a camera that captures visual information. However, this visual information is then processed by some machine learning or some computer vision algorithm. And then eventually, it will also make different types of interpretations of this visual information. So historically, we see that humans have been far more superior to computers in actually interpreting visual information. And I say historically because recently a young engineer called Alex Kaczewski published this paper on convolutional neural networks. And since then, in 2012, we have seen sort of a shift that suddenly in many different visual recognition tasks, we see that computers become more superior than humans. So this is really interesting, and it suddenly allows us to do a lot of new stuff. So, for example, if you want to have self-driving vehicles, well, they need to perceive the environment and act accordingly. So this is a good example, the Google car. However, in my project, we want to do self-driving tractors, autonomous tractors. So we'll use a sensor system like this, and then we'll perceive the environment. And the thing is then that if we can, the farmer doesn't need to be placed inside the vehicle, and we can have this vehicle operate by itself. And this project is a safe autonomous farming equipment project called SAFE. And we have different collaborators. And eventually, if we're able to make these algorithms that actually can do interpretations, then we have some of these collaborators that are able to realize these algorithms in actual robots. So back to the autonomous vehicles in the car industry. Typically, they use depth sensors. So sensors that can measure the environment with 3D positions. In this way, you can simplify your problem. So in this way, you can say all that just protrudes or resides on some road surface, well, we don't want to drive into that. Or you can map, you can have detailed 3D maps of the whole environment and simply detect what doesn't fit in that map. In this way, you can detect obstacles. So in an agriculture context, depth sensors are also very important. However, we need to handle some specific issues. So for example, we might have obstacles that resides in the crop and are hidden and or heavily occluded by some crop. So that's one of the first challenges. So this is specific for agriculture compared to cars. Also, what we quickly realized when we wanted to test algorithms is that we needed a data set with multiple sensors, multiple different sensors for obstacle detection in agriculture. For autonomous cars, there are a lot of different data sets for actually comparing, and so researchers can compete against each other and improve on existing state of the art. So a data set is quite important. And also what we saw is that many of these state of the art algorithms that we use in computer vision and machine learning and also in the automotive industry, well, we'd like to utilize them in an agricultural context for doing autonomous cars. And finally, we also want to think about how can we complement these different sensors. Different sensors that are able to see different things. So how can these sensors complement each other? So more specifically, I'll be working with an RGB camera and also a thermal camera. So the main thing is to detect obstacles, or specifically humans, in the field so we can have safe systems. And the overall research question that has driven this research has been, can farming vehicles use RGB and thermal cameras for obstacle detection? So now for the title, TractorEYE, vision-based real-time detection for autonomous vehicle in agriculture. And my two supervisors, Rasmus Nyman Jørgensen, Ben Karstoft, and my colleague, Mikkel Fyge Krav, he's working on LiDAR and radar, and together we're working on some of the sensors and the data. So this is actually an overview of my whole dissertation, and it consists of three components. So TractorEYE is basically a system that is able to generate images, and we're then able to detect specific objects in the image. These can then be converted into 3D objects, 3D positions in space. And finally, we have this local map representation. I'm going to discuss this more later. So that's one component. We also have this one, the position fusion and mapping. So it's basically taking all these local maps and converting them into some robotic map, or some map. And also finally we have this data set called FieldSafe, which I'm going to describe in a bit. So we'll start by going through chapter 4 and 5, which is the sensor platform. Sensor platform for collecting data and data collection. So basically a lot of data that have been used for evaluating and comparing algorithms. So this is our sensor platform mounted on a tractor. So if we zoom in a little, well, we can see a lot of different sensors. And I'll talk about these and mention these in a while, all of these. However, we are using ROS to interface to all these different sensors. So ensuring that we can connect to them and store information, replaying information. And also ROS is also good at actually doing the processing. So when we want our algorithms to run on a robotic system, we use ROS for executing them. So we have an RGB camera. That's what you know from your mobile phone. And in this way, we can capture visual information, texture and color and stuff like this. So we also have a stereo camera. This is the left camera. And basically, you can still see the same thing, so colors and texture and stuff like this. However, by utilizing both cameras, you can recognize a specific point in both cameras. And by using stereo matching, well, you're able to generate point clouds like this. So this is quite cool, where you're able to not only know the color of a specific pixel, but also know its position in space. So we also have a thermal camera where we want to that is able to know the temperature of each pixel in the image. We also have this very cool velodyne LiDAR. So this is a tractor, and there's some people going around here, and this is a shelter belt. And basically, this is able to constantly map the whole environment with 700,000 points a second. So it's quite an incredible sensor, also a very expensive one. And then we have GPS and IMU. And for the GPS, well, this is our sensor frame. Then IMU makes sure that we can constantly know the pose of our sensors in our system. And we can fuse this with the GPS. We have some dual internet GPS. So we are able, by fusing these information, we can know our exact position and the pose of our sensors. So a sub-module of this super sensor kit is the mini sensor kit. So this is also what I bought for you today, this little setup over here. And basically, it's some ruggedized sensor platform where you have some metal casing, and then you have a velodyne stereo camera and thermal camera mounted onto it. So the purpose is that you have your sensors completely fixed according to each other, and when you're in the field, well, you have this ruggedized casing, so that is suited for this environment. And another thing is that inside this, there's also a microcontroller, just a little computer, ensuring that the sensors are capturing information at the same time. And another advantage of this little sub-module is that you can actually place it on some robots. And in this example, this is the complex robot where it's been mounted on So that was the sensor platform. Now for data collection. So the aim of our data collection was to capture sort of realistic data. So we wanted a real tractor, we wanted a real operation in an agricultural field, and have similar obstacles, such obstacles in the field. And we did a lot of field trials and data collections, constantly iterating and improving on our trial, our data collection protocol, but also improving on our sensor kit. So this is the different field trials, and we're only focusing on the final. And we call that field safe data set. And we have sort of improved on the stereo camera and also on the thermal camera. And finally, the mini sensor kit, this has only been used for the final few recordings. Also, we have human obstacles, mannequin barrels, and also we are trying to also measure the ground truth, a combined of this. So basically, this is our static obstacles. We have mannequin dolls, and we have some barrels and some vehicle. And also we have moving dynamic obstacles that will move around in the field like this. And we divide this in two tracks, where we have our static track, and this is a red one, where we only have static obstacles, and we have the dynamic track, where we have these dynamic humans walking around. So the question is, how do we then measure this ground truth? How can we know what is actually positioned in this field? So for doing that, we have drones that fly before, under, and after the experiment. And if you have a drone picture, you will be able to reconstruct the scene at the day of the recording. And from a top view, well, you're able to label manually each of these pixels by its specific labels. So you have grass, you have road, you have shelter belts, trees, and you have buildings, stuff like this. So in this way, you're able to get static labels on the specific data set. So what about moving humans? Well, for this, we also use a drone, which is hovering above the scene, as you can see here. And this way, we can localize manually specific objects and their position in our setting. So the problem is that we don't know how to map any of these pixels into actual GPS coordinates in the real world. So how can we do that? Well, we do that by using we developed some tracking program that tracks specific points in the drone footage. And by knowing the exact GPS positions, measuring the exact GPS positions of these known positions, well, we're able to warp the image. And now we're able to take each of these points and map them into actual GPS positions. So that's how we ended up having these GPS positions in our map. And yeah, finally, we ended up also doing this, making this dataset publicly available. So we made this homepage where you can download data and also the ground truth and also calibrations between sensors. So all the contributions of this specific data set is that we've submitted a paper on it. We have also made this multi-sensor data set for optical detection in agriculture that we saw was needed to improve in this field. And we do it for both static and dynamic obstacles, and we're making this data set publicly available. So that was the sensor and the data collection section. So now we're coming to obstacle detection. And the main purpose of this is going from like an image like this and then detecting objects of interest in the image over here. And this is actually the main focus of my PhD and where most of my work has been focused on accomplishing this purpose. So there's different algorithms. And there's also some for thermal camera, but I will not discuss them in this dissertation. But you can ask questions later. Yes. So, yeah, what the main purpose is going from an image like this and then detecting humans in the image so you won't drive into them. So you might ask yourself, why is this so difficult? I can so easily spot humans in an image. Well, that's because what an algorithm actually sees is something totally different. So if an algorithm has to detect their face in this image, this is, I zoom in on that specific area, well, basically it's just a grid of numbers. And the algorithm needs to, by looking at these numbers, it needs to know that this is actually a face. And if you change the brightness, the contrast, if Rasmus, that's my boss, if you change his position, posture, or you're looking from the back, or he's not, if he's a different person, if he's a different gender or a different nationality, well, his face would look totally different. So it needs to be invariant to all these different deformations and still recognized as a face. So how could you actually improve on this? Well, you could make features of the image instead. So and represent this stuff. And these will be more invariant to some of these deformations. And what you then do is you have a lot of examples of humans, you have a lot of examples with no humans, and you calculate these features for both cases, and finally put it into this magic machine learning box, when they are able to distinguish what is human, what is not human. And finally, when you have a new case, then it's able to distinguish, is this a human or is it not a human? So how can you then do for a full image? And you do that by searching for humans of this particular size in the image, and it will then detect objects of similar size as this specific object. And this specific procedure is actually being accomplished in this local decoded channel features. However, so the features are called integral features, and they use edges and colors, as I just described. As the classifier, they use something called Adder Boost or Real Boost, and 2,000 decision trees in with a depth of 2 to actually distinguish the two classes. And then we can just see how that looks in a video of some kindergarten. So, yeah, the point is that it works sort of nicely, and the reason it does that, it has been trained on humans, pedestrians that are upright, so cylinder-shaped objects in the image space. So what then happens is that when this kid falls, well, it's suddenly not a cylinder in the image space, and the detector is not able to detect this. So then we have a problem. So the cool thing is that it's quite fast, however it's trained on fixed aspect ratios. So it's not able to learn elements that cannot be put inside these fixed aspect ratios. Another thing is that the features used in this are handcrafted. Some engineer figured out, well, edges and colors could be really nice for recognizing humans. However, if you change the subject, if you want to detect a vehicle or an animal, well, maybe different features would be applicable in this situation. And also the low-level features will come more into this. So the specific contributions related to this detector is that this has been used as a baseline, and it's also been evaluated and fused with other algorithms in pre-publication 4.10. I've converted it from MATLAB to C++ code, and then also developed some Rust packages, so people in the community can easily utilize this algorithm for their systems. So there's a need to improve on these obstacle detection algorithms, and that's where deep learning comes into play. And that's what Alex Krzyzewski somehow made more popular in 2012. So basically, from a mathematical point of view, you can say that this is a composition of simple nonlinear operations. And you can then do almost an arbitrary complicated function using deep learning. One way of representing this is using a neural network where you have some input and some hidden states and an output. And what happens is that the input is transformed by some nonlinear operation into some higher abstraction level. And this process is then repeated, and you can do that multiple times. And finally, you want to map this to some desired output. So the cool thing about this is that you can train this by examples, and you estimate the gradients throughout the network using the back propagation algorithm or the chain rule. In this way, you can slowly improve the internal parameters of this model. So this is also the model by Alex Krzyzewski, where you have some input image, and this is then using convolutions to constantly map. I just need to say something. So this is a neural network. This is not necessarily deep learning. So if you wanted this to be deep learning, well, you need to add in more layers and make it more complicated. And you can also use convolutions or neural networks to basically build bigger models things that defines deep learning is that you can learn from raw sets of data. So yeah, this is a model from SPCSP in 2012. You have some input image, and then you process this using convolutional layers. And finally, you have some fully connected layers that would map this to 1,000 different object classes. So the interesting thing is that this is trained all automatically by presenting image examples. And what we then see is that in the first layer, it will automatically learn edges and color features. So that's interesting because that was actually what engineers had figured out would be good for distinguishing if there's a human or not. However, it has the possibility to add multiple abstractions of this, higher abstractions of this. So you can combine these features into edges or lines or simple texture, and you can constantly improve on this to have more and more complicated features. And it's actually quite hard seeing what this is, but basically these neurons would eventually spike on complex features like a human face, a dog, or something like this. So we want to use this this new methodology of deep learning to detect a specific object. And this has a specific story, so we call it kill the isobarrel. And this specific barrel has been specified in this standardized obstacle that has been specified in this ISO 18497. And it's agricultural machinery and tractor safety of highly automated agricultural machines. So the point is, and their argument is that if you're able to detect this barrel, you have a safe system. And this is absolutely not true. So maybe that makes sense for if you have a depth sensor that only can see depth information. Well, if you can detect something like this, then it might be a safe system. But if you have an RGB camera, well, this doesn't really resemble a human, for example. So. So we wanted to highlight that this probably is not that good an idea. So what we did is we used this algorithm described in multi-view face detection using convolutional neural networks, where they use faces and non-faces to train the network. So in our case, we swapped out the faces with barrels and then also have these negatives. And the data collection was simply just 5 videos using a mobile phone. So, what we actually managed to do was we were able to quite really nicely actually detect this barrel in also in rough lighting conditions. However, these humans that are placed in the field, we did not detect those, and the animals as well. So it's not safe. That's the main pointer of this paper, that you need to be careful how you specify your safety standards. And we also have to realize that it could also detect this barrel even if it was a quite occluded scene. So apart from that, if we see on the detector as itself, well, we suddenly have self-taught high-level features, and it's also potentially able to learn much more obstacles. So not just the barrels, but also multiple other obstacles. So the problem is that it's not real-time, and it still uses these fixed aspect ratios. So yeah, and this was published in this Using Deep Learning to Challenge Safety Standard for Highly Autonomous Machines in Agriculture in Journal of Engineering. So we shift to the next thing, which is sort of this category of fast deep learning optical detections. And this is a very cool field, and it's basically didn't exist for more than for 3-4 years ago. So these are certainly able to detect multiple obstacles with objects with multiple aspect ratios, and they're able to do it really good and also quite fast. And there are 2 specific branches within this field. One is region proposal algorithms, where we have an algorithm proposing 2,000 regions in an image, a lot of different proposals, and these proposals then feed it forwarded through a network. And this is demonstrated to work quite nicely. However, it's fast, but it could be faster. And this is what one particular guy have utilized in YOLO, where you only have a single forward pass through the network, and by the end of the network you will have all your detections. So you can imagine that this is faster, however it was actually hard actually being able to do this and using the right techniques for actually getting there. So if you take the same sample example from before, well, suddenly we're able to detect this human with a different aspect ratio. So that is quite cool. So, and they're real time, they can handle variable aspect ratios, they can have multiple object types and postures, and features are self-taught, and they can use these high level features. So the contribution is that this has been used, the fast action has been used as a baseline. YOLO and YOLO 2 has also been used in the baseline in publication 1. And they have also been evaluated and fused with other algorithms in paper 4 and 10. And also a Rust package has been developed, so other people can easily utilize this algorithm in for their application. For example, this complex robot. So now we think we solved it, we're able to detect obstacles, and now everything is good. However, in an agricultural context, well, you might also want to know where is actually the crop. Where is roads, where is shelter belts, and where are buildings and stuff like this. And these are not nicely represented with a bounding box. So if you want to put a bounding box around this road, it's weakly represented using a bounding box. And the same goes for other elements in an image. So how to solve this? That's using semantic segmentation. And the purpose of semantic segmentation is that you have some input image and you want to classify every single pixel in this image. And there's different solutions, and actually this field is also moving quite rapidly. And we are using one of the first of these algorithms, the FGN8. So one problem is that typically, well, these algorithms are trained on data where you only have annotated objects. So that would be humans and a motorcycle like this. However, we would like to have labels of the road and the trees and grass and elements like these. So luckily somebody did this for us. In some paper they used 6 people and 3 months full time annotating whole images like this. So we used these whole image labels and we used the 59 most frequent classes and remap them to agricultural specific classes. And in this way you can able to take an image like this and map it into something like this, where the algorithm says there's field, there's ground, there's people, and there's shelter belt. And we also evaluated this in an agricultural context where we have 5 images in grass mowing situation and 5 in a row crop situation. And what we see is that we're able to classify these pixels by 95% pixel classification accuracy. In row crops, we performed not as good, with an only an accuracy of 70. So, and the problem is that some of these images are hard because the sun is always posing the camera, and also row crops was not represented in the data. However, it's still able to make these quite nice interpretations of the world, where we see fields, tractor, humans, shelter belt, roads, sky, buildings, and stuff like this. So it's actually quite a cool algorithm to detect these things. So it's almost real time. It's a bit slower than the other algorithms. There's a lot of improvement in this field, and some algorithms are extremely fast compared to this. However, we solved this problem that we cannot only represent things using a bounding box, which is a very rough way of representing. And also this was presented in publication 7, and we also used this as a baseline, and we also fused it and evaluated with other algorithms. And finally, we also developed a Rust package so people in the community could easily use this algorithm. So again, we might think we did it. We solved it, now we're able to detect also what is field and what is road and all these different things that are also interesting in agriculture. However, the problem is that we still have some objects that are heavily included, meaning that we can almost not see that there's a human in here. However, we can see that there is something. And also there might be obstacles that we wouldn't want to train on. We wouldn't imagine there's a boat in our agricultural field. We wouldn't imagine there would be a tent. But we wouldn't train our classifier on these specific objects because it would very rarely appear. So what could we then do? We could redefine our problem, saying that we need to detect anomalies, which is called anomalies. So the overall concept is that, well, in an agricultural field, well, you have and this image there that is visually very homogeneous. So there's not a lot of weird stuff going on in this image. And by then modeling how normal data looks like, we have plenty of normal data in agricultural context. We can model how normal data looks like, and then we can then detect these outliers. And we want to utilize these new interesting deep learning algorithms. So we use AlexNet, we pre-train it for image classification, and we need to remember that this final layer, well, we have these advanced high abstraction features. So we have neurons in these layers that spike on high level features, such as a dog or human, things like this. So we could basically utilize these high level features in a new branch called anomaly, which we have defined as an anomaly detection module, where we basically want to detect outliers, things that doesn't conform to the normal model. So how would this look like? So if we have an input image, that's also represented up here, we feed it through the network. We have then these, this feature map that represents the input image. So this specific feature map entry describes this area in the original image. But first we reshape this particular image, it's just one long feature vector. We add another image, and suddenly we can have an even longer feature vector. And then we have these features, well, typically we will have in the range of 256 or 500 or 1,000 features, but I've only represented 5 of these features. So the point is that we can map, that we can model the normal model for each of these features individually. This is not, I guess this is not so clear from the back row, but I've sort of put up just representing feature 1 and 2, and you can imagine that could be potentially 256 features in this representation. So the goal is, if we then have some sample, then we want to measure how far is this from the normal model. So how can we do that when we have a lot of samples that represent the normal model? So one way is that we simply calculate the mean value of all these samples of normal data. And that's a very simple way of representing how a normal, the normal data is represented. And then we can simply measure the distance between these using the Euclidean distance. And in this way, if you define then some threshold, well, all that resides outside this threshold can be defined as an outlier. However, we could do something more, even more complex. So if we want to model the underlying variance represented in our normal data, well, we could maybe try to model each feature using their variance. And we did that with a single variate Gaussian, meaning that we modeled each feature individually, how we did them independently. We can also model them dependently. Then we call it a multivariate Gaussian, meaning that instead we will model the variance and if we then have a new sample like this one, we will then measure the Mahalanobis distance. And the thing is that if you then specify a threshold, it would define a threshold that sort of resembles the underlying variance in the data. And furthermore, you could also imagine, well, that our normal data is not only distributed in one little cluster, we could also have multiple clusters. So there might also be some Gaussian distribution over here that describes another state sort of in our normal data. And we can then use, actually measure these, if this is normal data, we can actually recognize these two clusters in the data using Gaussian mixture model by some expectation maximization algorithm. And in this way, then if you have a new sample, well, we can simply measure the distance to the closest of these clusters. And this way you can more nicely model the background. And what we then saw is that, well, if we take the simple model mean and the median value, well, it's not we're not getting that high accuracy. If we use the variance-based models, we get sort of an equally high accuracy. However, if you use a Kenyan, I actually haven't described that. So you could also imagine if we have Kenyan, that we measure the distance to the closest point in our data. So if you have a point out here, this would be far away to the nearest neighbor, which is this one. However, if we are positioned here, the distance to the nearest neighbor would be quite small. And this actually performs quite good for this provided data set. So we also tried different layers. So you saw that we used the final features from layer 5, that's up here. We could also do it before the rectifying linear unit using simply the convolutional layer. And similarly, we could continue to use simpler and simpler features from this convolutional neural network. What we also see is that we slowly degrade, the performance slowly degrades as we use lower and lower features. And then also we did other stuff that I won't go into details. We also tested a VGG network. So basically we end up with a lot of different settings, 400 different settings. And a lot of these settings were actually equally good in some way. At least in terms of how accurately they could detect an object. So we also wanted to range them according to how fast they were. And this ended up with this plot where we have accuracy in computations. So down here we have high performance in speed and classification accuracy. And yeah, actually we ended up using a super simple model because that actually ended up working just as good as any of the more advanced, and it was also very fast. So how does it act? Good, does it actually work? Well, it actually works better than expected, I would say, when I first tried this algorithm. So it's able to detect these elements, also at quite far distance, they detect different obstacles. So my problem is, well, I can see that this actually performs quite good, and also compared to all these algorithms that I've presented to you, I also saw that well, it actually does the job of this really, really good compared to what you otherwise would do if you had to solve this problem. So how could I actually compare this? And I did that I tried to compare it to the state-of-the-art algorithms that I presented to you. So it's a bit like comparing oranges and apples. It's different. Some of them are object detectors, some of them are semantic segmentation, and this one is anomaly detectors. They're basically different things. But I wanted to evaluate them for their ability to detect a specific object. And by doing so, I was able to compare them using this common metric. And I used humans. And basically what I did is that all that is I have to speed up, I see. All that is I valued on specific on humans. And all that is not humans was simply ignored. And then I saw that deep anomaly was able to it's obtained a higher classification accuracy, and also I saw for different distance intervals, well, deep anomaly was better at detecting humans. So suddenly we have this deep anomaly, it's able to detect unknown, heavy occluded, and very distant obstacle. It's real time. The training becomes quite easy. You just need, in my case, I just used 56 images in an agricultural context. And we were able to get those results I presented. And also in this case, I used the same model to get these predictions. One little fun thing is this, there's a specific, I thought this was a false positive, but there's actually a watermark that resides in the image that is detected. And yeah, so the big problem is that it's very case specific. It's not a generic algorithm like any of the other algorithms, so it only works for specific situations, like in a cultural case. So I actually wanted to try to execute this model in this room. So I went out and did a recording of this room, and hopefully I would model the normal model of this room. And on the day of presentation, which is today, well, hopefully there would be some anomalies, new anomalies in the scene. So it's not where it's. So now we have the camera. I hope. So suddenly we have a lot of different anomalies in this scene. So if I picture myself on some of this table and chairs, there's no real spikes. And maybe also my computer is also looking a bit weird. Yeah. So it's not that it's perfect, however, it was quite simple actually to utilize it for some other use case. This So that was the obstacle detection part. Yeah? Oh, thank you. So yeah, I have to speed up. So this basically the point was to go from this to making detections. And you can then map these detections to 3D, and finally you can map them into a camera ISM. So we call this an inverse sensor model. Whoa, I'm way out of time. Yeah, I can show you another demo. So I have to switch again. So this is the tractor, the output of the tractor. So we have the middle line, and we have the RGB camera, and we're also detecting various things. And this is the deep anomaly algorithm, and this is YOLO represented up here. And we're also able to represent some these local maps. So this represents what the different algorithms sees from a top view. So I can see this is for the deep anomaly. So places where there are humans, it would say there's something occupying this space. And you can also do it for grass. And you can also show this. No. So this also represents, so this is for example for the grass case. So, what you just saw was before that basically we're able to make these, and I can't go into details. There's a whole chapter about this, but I can't go into details. And finally, we want to do localization, fusion, and mapping. And the point of this is taking these inverse sensor models and then mapping them and using them to create a new map. So you can imagine if you have the pose and the position of your robot, where you're able to take the inverse sensor, inverse sensor models of all the different algorithms and map them into some new map, as you see represented down here. And this was some work I did together with Timo and also Mikkel, and we used a lot of contribution was required to actually realize this. So we had to make a sensor platform, we had to make sensor registration, a data set, we had to make multiple detection algorithms, we had the four RGB algorithms that I have presented, we also had three algorithms for thermal camera, radar, and LiDAR. We also aligned these using these inverse sensor models that I presented to you in the demo. And we also needed to localize the robot and the pose of the robot. And finally, we used occupancy semantical grid maps to make these maps. And basically, they are maps like this. I'll need to skip through this. But imagine you can also have multiple maps, one representing where is grass, another map representing where is road, another map representing where is human. And basically, you could take in your inverse sensor models and slowly place these small local maps into the global map. And eventually, you will have a map like this. If you have the tractor driving around in this trajectory, well, eventually you will have mapped this whole scene. And what we see is that here and here and here and here, there are placed some mannequins, some humans, and the YOLO algorithm is able to detect them in these specific spots. So, but the main point of actually representing and using these occupancy grid maps is that we want to fuse information from multiple sensors. So we can have a map for each algorithm and each object in algorithm. So we have, for example, human, for the fully connected semantic segmentation, we have human, grass, and ground, and different classes. And then we can then fuse these maps. So in this particular case, in the human case, we can go from the YOLO. We can fuse this information using some Bayesian fusion, and then we can end up improving our end result. So I cannot actually go into details, but the whole point is that you can have made these specific maps for each algorithm, and you can aim to fuse this information using from multiple sensors. Finally I ended up representing the whole pipeline going from input to output, representing stuff in this map. And remember, this map is important for robots to actually do interactions in the world. So doing path planning and controlling. And I also have made a slightly more complicated figure of this thing where all the publications and contributions are put into each of these modules. And then different papers and how they have changed, some states have changed. This is not so related to the SAFE project to autonomous vehicles. And then also the GitHub, which is basically Rust packages that people can use and implement on their own robots. And finally, there was a lot of requirements from the SAFE project as well, and we managed to complete most of them and somehow complete some of them. And generally, we can say that overall contributions for autonomous vehicles in summarize what have my contributions been to autonomous vehicles in agriculture. What we saw originally, well, we had this problem of detecting these unknown distance and heavy occluded obstacles. So we did deep anomaly, which was able to quite effectively solve this problem. We also saw that we needed a data set with multiple sensors for the context in autonomous vehicles in agriculture. So we did the field safe and made this publicly available so other regions could compete and compare and improve their algorithms according to compared to each other. And finally, we also saw that many of these state-of-the-art algorithms have not been utilized for the autonomous domain in agriculture. And we did the TractorEYE, which sort of is a whole pipeline for processing image data. And finally, we also have this multimodal fusion where we have multiple sensors, multiple algorithms with different formats, and we were able to fuse all these different types of information into specific maps. And we used ISMs and semantical occupancy grid maps. Finally, applicable was also a key word. So can this actually be used in real life? Can these results actually be used in agriculture? So we had a specific, real time was always a real important issue when we did these algorithms. We also made a lot of publicly available ROS packages. And finally, we also demonstrated a full pipeline of how such a perception system could work for an autonomous vehicle. And seen in a broader perspective, well, if you want to do an autonomous vehicle, well, you need to sense the environment. I have said that quite a few times now. But you also need to plan, act and control your vehicle. And our stuff has mostly been related to sensing. However, we believe that these initial steps have been is able to improve on development of also the other tasks. Yeah. That's it. Thank you.